Tomorrow morning's remembrance service at the Cenotaph in Whitehall can be seen on BBC One starting at 10:30, with a recording of the event being shown at 7:15 tomorrow evening on BBC Two.
Discovering the mysteries and customs of the Far East, their Royal Highnesses, the Prince and Princess of Wales, on tour in Indonesia and Hong Kong. Martin Lewis presents Royal Mission tomorrow at 5:40 on BBC One.
In 45 minutes, Burt Reynolds stars as a poor but honest Los Angeles policeman involved in a brutal murder case. His co-stars in Hustle are Catherine Deneuve and Eddie Albert. First, we join Sue Lawley for more entertaining Saturday Matters.
On thin ice tonight as we deal with a subject to which no one is indifferent. Call it love, call it lust, call it desire, or call it sex. It extends from Romeo and Juliet to page 3 of The Sun and beyond. But don't get overexcited, because our aim is to illuminate, not to titillate, as we meet the playwright Dennis Potter, whose provocative works for television include Pennies from Heaven and The Singing Detective. I'll also be talking to an actor who's currently playing a Greek Casanova in the hit film Shirley Valentine. That's Tom Conti. And we'll be rounding off the show with a celebration of love as Elaine Page and John Barrowman bring us a song from Cole Porter's Anything Goes. But first, an interview with a man who has the reputation of never giving interviews. In this country, he set female hearts aflutter through his work for the Blue Moon Detective Agency in that superior American import, Moonlighting. Since then, he's become a bankable Hollywood star and a chart-topping singer. Before I talk to him, courtesy of satellite, let's have a taste of Save the Last Dance for Me from Mr. Bruce Willis.
You can dance. Every dance with the guy that gives you the eye and let him hold you tight. You can smile, every smile for the man that held your hand beneath the pale moonlight. But don't forget who's taking you home, and in his arms you're gonna be.
A London welcome for you, Bruce.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's nice to be there.
That, or not quite, as the case may be. That was your baby daughter, wasn't it, we saw at the end of the video there?
Yeah, right at the... That's a little, just a little wave hello to her, I guess.
What's her name? How old is she?
Her name is Rumor.
She's
a Rumor, R-U-M-E-R.
It's obviously changed you a lot, fatherhood. Have you found it quite a humbling experience?
It has, in mostly good ways. It's fun, you know, being a father, you certainly...
We're cleaning the air. Do you see any program in sight which would change the minds of these farmers?
Right now, there are no incentives for them to change their mind. All of the incentives here are for clearing.
It will need to be filled out.
At the United Nations on Wednesday, Mrs. Thatcher offered help.
We shall give special help to manage and preserve the tropical forests. And as a new pledge, I can announce today that we aim to commit a further £100 million bilaterally to tropical forestry activities over the next 3 years, mostly within the framework of the Tropical Forestry Action Plan.
Aid for forestry is welcome, but the amounts from Britain and other donors are dwarfed by the size of the problem. Not just trees are burned. India and China have vast reserves of coal, which they plan to burn to meet the demands of their expanding populations. The cost of persuading them to hold back hasn't begun to be quantified. If the developing world is not to tear the environment apart as a matter of self-preservation, Stephen Lewis says tens of billions of dollars will be needed every year.
Well, if in fact you want to restore your forests, massive programs of forest regeneration, if in fact you want to restore your agricultural soils, so that economies are functioning again and self-sufficient, if in fact you want to have enough money in the economy to look for alternative sources of energy, for example, heating communities all over the developing world with solar energy, with photovoltaic cells, rather than with fossil fuels, if you want to do all of that and stop the greenhouse effect in its tracks in the developing world, you've got to have some resources.
Developing countries are unlikely to get significant resources without hefty strings attached. International diplomacy will aim for agreements and protocols which tie the developing world to environmentally sound practice, but it won't be easy.
I think it's very likely that when we come to work our way through these protocols and the whole concept of climate change in the 1990s, that the whole question of enforcement of protocols will be at the center of that. And it could be multilateral enforcement, it could be bilateral enforcement, in that individual countries can take measures against other countries if they've not complied with the protocol. But we really have not sorted all that out, and it's going to be lots and lots of talk amongst lots and lots of diplomats before that's done.
I'm not terribly hopeful. I'm kind of shocked at how slow is the policy response on the part of the politicians. It's almost as slow as the time it took between the moment in Hiroshima and the arms agreements of the late 1980s. Except on the environment, we don't have over 40 years to wait.
There are measures individual countries could take now with little economic risk to slow global warming. But if politicians wait for international agreement before even starting, the pessimists' fears may be fulfilled.
In just under 55 minutes, the last of our series telling the Magnum story includes a photographic diary of events in China last June, as recorded by a group of Magnum photographers. Now on BBC Two, highlights of this morning's Remembrance Day service at the Cenotaph in Whitehall, where Her Majesty the Queen laid her wreath of poppies in memory of those who lost their lives in two world wars. The commentator is David Dimbleby.